Right off the bat, get your Google on. PFSense is a great open source kind of router firewall you can use. You can also use VirtualBox for virtualization, meaning you have a host operating system and then you build smaller virtual machines on that host operating system to build that lab. You're definitely gonna need resources like RAM. So if you can afford it, build your own server. It's typically cheaper that way. PC Part Pickers is a great website to kind of get going on that. You can create a virtualized infrastructure that includes PFSense for routing and firewall kind of network segmentation, whether it's through a virtual LAN or you have an entirely separate network, a /24 to kind of play around with. You want to get after some Windows servers, some Windows workstations, Windows 10s, Windows Server 2016, and build virtual machines with these operating systems. And then create what's called an Active Directory domain. And once you have an Active Directory domain, which is very similar to what you'll see in an enterprise domain, you want to then build a Linux machine. You can use a different distribution like Kali or ParrotOS, etc., to have an attacking machine, and then you just go after it. And if you don't want to buy one of those big bulky servers, I recommend maybe Raspberry Pis or an Intel Nook. Those are great places to start if you want something more compact that can, bring some resources into that virtualized environment.
What does your loadout look like? Some of the tools you use day to day?
For the blue side of things, really understand log management. So tools like Asim, go out there and get Security Onion 2.0. It was just released. It's a great tool set to get start off with. You're going to get exposure to Elk. You're going to get exposure to the Hive, which is like a case management tool. Check out tools like Mist for intelligence feeds, Wazoo or OS Query for endpoint protection. Sysmon is an amazing tool you can deploy on a Windows environment to get some really good security login in place. Take a look at EXXI for virtualization. And I'm huge into scripting from a defensive standpoint. So PowerShell, I can use PowerShell to query any data source that I want from a Windows enterprise environment, and also Python. So integrating with APIs and different tooling with Python is also kind of in my tool suite. From an attacker perspective, I think GitHub is the best place for an attacker. Just to name a few, for open source intelligence, take a look at Spiderfoot, do so responsibly. Tools like Amass to do some subdomain enumeration, Active Directory tooling like Inpacket or Rubius, Bloodhound. If you haven't deployed Bloodhound and ran it on an Active Directory environment, go ahead and pause the video, go out and get it done, because Bloodhound is a great tool to map out an entire Active Directory domain. And then I'll finish it from the offensive aspect of, some command and control tooling. So like Covenant or Mythic, Empire, PowerShell Empire is still very popular, day to day, and maybe Merlin is another great one.
How do you kind of keep track? Are you pen and papering?
For me, really keeping track of everything on a Google Drive is essential in terms of documents. If I find a really good PDF or white paper out there, I have a Google Drive where I put some of those tech articles or blog posts before they could get taken down or, I lose the link. Having solid bookmarks also helps. I keep tons of bookmarks depending on the different topics within security, whether it's blue teaming, pen testing. From a tooling perspective, you can definitely keep a OneNote of all the tools that you've kind of experienced and keep a running tab of that. I think that's one of the best things you can do in security is just have solid notes for yourself.
There's a lot of people who are only interested in Kali, hacking, red team, that kind of stuff. And there's people who are only in the PCAPs and logs and the forensics. What would you say to those people having a day-to-day experience in both?
I mean, I would say as a defender, right, we tend to focus a lot on logs, host-based artifacts, network traffic, etc. But until you understand from a tactical level how the adversary tactics are performed, you won't get to that deep level of understanding those tactics, which will lead into your detection engineering effort. And then as an attacker, most pen testers or red teamers I know, they really don't like the blue teaming side of things. All they want to do is, pwn, get root, call it a day, etc. But it's really understanding, how can I improve this organization from a security posture? You can gain huge value and focus in on how can you help the blue team? How can you help the defense? understand your tactics, understand those CTPs, so that next time you try those CTPs, they already know how to detect it.
Tell me, what is your personal take on certifications?
I think, you know, training yourself in your home labs and getting few certifications that kind of meet some of those criteria, and you taking those certifications seriously based on the curriculum and the learning objectives, not so much to check off the box. I think that's where the value of certifications come from. But other than that, I'm not a huge fan of certifications, especially like you mentioned, if you just go out and get the plethora of CompTIA certifications just to have them, it really doesn't give you those skills that you're going to need to kind of be successful on the job. Some of the certifications I do recommend for anyone in security are something like the OSCP. Some of the e-learning security certifications are pretty good as well. And whether they're valuable or not, I would just grab the take of certifications as a way for you to improve yourself. You really want to make sure you take that specific topic and you focus on that topic. So I wouldn't necessarily put a certification as this is needed because it is a job requirement, but it's also a way for you to focus on, I need to learn this specific topic. So you put a goal to get that certification to push you to understand that specific topic.
You mentioned the tier one through tier three SOC analysts. Could you break apart some of the skills and even salary ranges?
I've seen ranges starting at 75,000 to higher than 250,000. I think that salary range, you know, definitely location will depend on, you know, what your salary is, and then your experience level and, you know, your problem solving, not only from a keyboard standpoint, you know, technically speaking, but also, you know, being that entrepreneur mindset, understanding the operational risk, understanding how you tie into a bigger picture of that company. But the ranges are pretty crazy, and it really just depends on the industry. As a tier one, I expect the SOC analyst to really understand the foundations of networking, of operating systems, architecture, maybe even a basic level of reading code. Really, once you get into the middle tier, that means, you know, you understand a deeper level of traffic, PCAP, you know, host-based artifacts. It's not just you going through alerts and seeing what's going on, but you really can get deep into certain investigations. And at that tier three, you know, I think you're really more a standalone analyst where you can do a lot for the organization, to include writing your own tools, maybe your own scripting. You can build your own detection engineering rules or specific tooling. It's really more of a development work role with all the analysis already kind of fine-grained in your arsenal.
What was the interview process for you getting into your job role?
I would say it was almost a full-time job, having interviews all the time. You have to keep track of good notes, all the conversations, because these tech interviews, they may refer, you know, they may go back and ask you deeper details of a topic they asked you in interview number one. All my offensive interviews, all I kept doing was hacking boxes on Hack the Box so I can, you know, stay fresh on some of the tactics. I was reading blog posts every day. I had kind of a fine-grained methodology to exploitation. I was following different Twitter, you know, accounts. I was staying up to date with all the latest tactics and how to detect. So for me, it was just surfing the internet and just staying really up to date with everything going on, and then writing down my talking points. I think I can't emphasize enough of keep track of a notebook. I had a physical notebook for my interview process where I would, you know, have different talking points, whether it's an adversary tactic or how to detect against a specific common tactic. For this specific work role, I had first a managerial interview with a senior exec of the company, to make sure culture and, you know, things of that nature were going to be a fit. Then I had three technical interviews with some of their senior engineers. After those three tech interviews, I went back to another exec to make sure culture, et cetera, was going to be good. And then the final piece was having an offer letter delivered to me.
What was your journey like, kind of in terms of your skill progression?
I would say a lot of the times while I was in my initial first tech job there at the sleep apnea company, it was really self-taught, you know, teaching myself what a domain is, what is a domain controller, what is an IP address, et cetera. So a lot of the fundamentals I had to kind of teach myself as I was going through my undergraduate degree. But it was great because, you know, I got that firsthand experience of being a Windows system administrator the hard way prior to going into security. I was a one person shop. So, you know, I couldn't turn to any coworkers about, you know, regarding questions on the domain or any sort of configurations. So for me, it was really just being alone and having to Google my way to finding answers to the problems that I was facing. I think some of the best resources are actually blog articles by other security researchers, other companies. So I'm heavily into Twitter, you know, companies like SpectreOps, Black Hills Information Security, Red Siege, et cetera. And even some of the overseas companies like MDSEC from the UK. You know, following some of that research and some of those employees that are within the security spectrum really helped me, you know, learn some of the tradecraft that they're doing. I'm not huge on books, simply because some of the security books are really dry. So I'm bigger into YouTube channels, you know, like Keith Adams, this one specifically, IPSEC for the Hack the Box walkthroughs. I like to learn via videos. Some of the podcasts I have listened to, you know, from Hack 5 and the Coalfire team, have also been helpful. But for me, it's really just blog posts, Twitter, and YouTube videos. I know a lot of people do CTFs in my industry, but I typically just wait for the walkthroughs. I like to start at the beginning and just walk through some of the blog posts of the solutions. Though it is beneficial to get involved, you know, it can be time consuming if you're participating in a couple. But for me, really where I gain most of my value of my time is kind of banging my head against the keyboard in my home lab. So I like to go out and build infrastructure, you know, break it, test it, and learn the ins and outs of those specific TTPs and adversary mirror leverage, how I can detect against it.
You are a pretty technical, I would say, you know, manager or leader in your team. What are some words of wisdom or advice you might have for less technical people?
Yeah, so I would say to be a leader in anything that you do and not just security, you have to understand what your subordinates are going through, meaning you have to understand some of the technical implications of what they go through, what jobs, you know, they do. I'm not asking every security manager out there to be a reverse engineer, but what I'm asking for is allocate some of your personal time, if you don't have it at work, to understand the technical aspects that your analysts have to go through to do their jobs well. Because at the end of the day, nothing gets done unless, you know, the tactical echelon executes those tasks. For me, really, that leadership aspect that was ingraining me through, you know, the military and up was take care of those people, understand them at a personal level, understand their goals, challenge them technically, give them meaningful work. And then sometimes even some of the not so awesome work, whether it's writing reports, et cetera, give them that sense of importance that their work is really towards a greater cause for the company. Giving them that level of satisfaction and thanking them for everything that they do for you, I think goes a long way.
Awesome, awesome. What are some things that you do personally to kind of stay secure?
My mother had a phishing email saying that they had her email account, her password, which was true because her account was leaked somewhere else and she never changed her credentials. And they tried to, you know, blackmail her for that information. You know, we didn't go through it. You know, we changed her credentials immediately all across the board. I implemented multi-factor authentication on all her banking websites, et cetera. So some of the things I do and I always preach to my family members are implementing a good password policy, you know, internally. Using password managers is a big, you know, recommendation I give to everyone. You know, the times of having your personalized, your own password being repeated across every single platform that you use, those times are gone and it's pretty dangerous. So implementing multi-factor on everything, changing credentials with a password manager on everything, I think those are some of the initial wins that people can get after improving their security.